It's after lunch. I know you all want to fall asleep. This is the worst time to be a presenter, so you're going to have to give me a little bit of slack and try and stay awake. As part of that, this is going to be an interactive workshop. Now, what most of you probably didn't expect is that I'm actually going to be asking you to do some mathematics through this course. So your brains need to be activated. Okay? I need you to think. I need to be able to do, to be fair, basic arithmetic. But it is coming. Be aware. Those of you sitting on tables of one, right, who are actually participating, please move into another table. Okay? We're going to be doing this in groups. This is a workshop. I will try and limit my rambling to a minimum as possible. So, let's start with a fairly quick show of hands. Who here is using Kanban? About half of you. Okay. Of the people who didn't put your hands up, how many of you know what Kanban is? Okay, not too bad. All right. How many here has, you don't really know what Kanban is, you've never used it, you're here to learn from the very beginning? A few of you. Okay, so for those of you who are starting from the very beginning, I am going to go very quickly. All right, so if you have questions about some of the core principles and some of the core ideas which I'm overlooking and you're unsure, just stick your hand up, interrupt me, and I'll be happy to like go into a little bit more detail and address some of those issues. All right, now, this talk is a little bit different to the majority of Kanban talks. Can we be a bit louder? So this is going to be a little different to the usual Kanban talks that you've probably heard. I'm actually not going to talk about Kanban until towards the very end. Why? Because Kanban itself is a tool for visualizing and tracking flow. But what is your flow? What is the process flow that you're undertaking and going through? Now, each organization, every division, department, team within the organization, interacts with hundreds of processes on a daily basis. Each one of these processes, each one of these ways of working is in itself what we call a value stream. It's called a value stream because at the end of the process, you have created something that creates value for the organization. If it doesn't create value, then you probably shouldn't be doing it in the first place. All right? Does that make sense? So that's the value stream in the value stream map. Now, the second part which you need to understand is when you are creating those these value streams and defining these process flows, we're only really interested in common processes. If you do something once, it's not repeatable. There's no point in tracking or visualizing it. These are activities that you do over and over again. Another thing to note for those of you who are a little bit more pedantic, this is a model. This is an abstraction of reality. You cannot, and it is impossible to fully define a reality-based process. Reality is by its very nature chaotic. All right? Business by its very nature is chaotic. Things occur which are outside your control. The value stream map is defining the flow in an existing baseline process and is an abstraction and a simplification of reality. Remember that. Do not expect that you're going to do every little choice and option and different way in terms of the modeling. Make sense? All right. So with those caveats, who am I? For those of you who haven't met me yet, my name is Evan Laybourne. I currently am based out of Singapore, but originally come from Australia. So I'm particularly happy with the cricket scores from yesterday. So to be honest, I was expecting to be not let into the country, but apparently you guys are fairly forgiving about that sort of thing. All right. My speciality is about agile outside IT. I take agile businesses, I take IT functions, and I improve the interfaces to HR, to finance, and to the extent where I will actually take a finance division, a HR division, a sales and marketing division, and turn it into an agile organization. That's me, that's the sort of stuff I do, and you probably don't care, so I won't go into much detail. What you do care about is this. All right, who knows what this is? Seven principles. Lean, yes. Who here has heard of the Agile Manifesto? Please tell me it's more than half of you. You're at an Agile conference, you should know the Agile Manifesto. These are some more principles, okay? Agile and Lean like their principles. These are value statements that tell you why we're doing the work that we're doing. All right? Have a read of these. Understand them. This is what Kanban and Lean is built upon. This is the predication of how it all works. Right? If you can understand these core principles, then you're half of the way to actually understanding why we're working the way that we're doing. Now, this isn't a talk about values, this isn't a talk about principles, this is a workshop. So you can read, you can understand them as best you can. Right? Where the principles apply, I will call those out. But just be aware of what they are and how they work. This is a value stream map. Right? This is a value stream. Can anyone tell me what this value stream map is for? Manufacturing? No, it's not a manufacturing. A value stream map. Sorry. A value stream map is for optimizing the flow, yes. But what is this value stream map for? What kind of software development? Waterfall software development. I've used an agile lean process, a value stream map, to define a waterfall process. Why? Because we can. Any repeatable process that has a value at the end of it, which they all should, is a candidate for a value stream map. So let's talk about some of the primary components of the value stream map and what you're seeing. Okay. This is the input. Okay. A request comes in and says, this is what we're trying to do. Okay. It's a wish list in a project sense. Right. This is the output. We're producing something of value to our users. These boxes here, these are our states. These are the activities that a process, a system will go through in order to deliver value. Every single one of those boxes adds value to the process. If it doesn't add value to the process, it is a candidate for removal, as in get rid of the process step altogether. Right. Who can tell me what this is? Value at a time. Who said duration? Someone said duration. Congratulations. It is duration. This is not effort. This is duration. Okay. These are time-based measures. These are averages. Where you have a process that has a deviation of or an absolutely massive deviation from process to process, it can be very hard to define a lot of this information. We're really looking, this kind of map is really looking at consistent processes where the deviation is plus or minus 50%. Rather than plus or minus 1,000%. But what about this here? Who said waste? That's it. That's the word you want. It's called non-value add time. It is the time spent in between process steps. Okay? Value add time plus non-value add time equals total time. Does that make sense? This is fairly simple, basic stuff. I want you to understand it. Any questions about this? No? Good. Now, there's one other piece of information in here. This, your efficiency and your throughput. Okay. Now, efficiency is not necessarily what you think it is. And it's not necessarily something that you want to have a very high efficiency. There are cases, and I will explain this a bit later, where a low efficiency is actually more beneficial. Okay, and I will explain that a bit later in the course. But efficiency is very simple, and this is where I said you're going to have to do some mathematics in this course. But the efficiency is the value add time divided by the total time. Okay, make sense? Yep. So requirements, so in this process, okay, let me talk you through this specific process. A business unit raises a request. It goes into a wish list. It takes them a day to raise that request, okay? It then takes about 6 months for this, for the business analysts, realistically, to pick that object off the wish list and begin analyzing it, all right? It goes through a funding process. That funding process looks at, are we actually going to fund this? Yes, we are. If we're not, we kick out of the value stream because it's not going to proceed. Okay, it takes about a month from being funded to the requirements being started. Requirements analysis in this case, once again, we're talking waterfall, takes about 6 weeks. In those 6 weeks, you provide a solution build summary of a couple of hundred pages. It then takes 6 months from writing the SBS to getting the developers or getting the contract with the offshore team to actually write the code. Development and testing takes about 3 months. A 2 month waiting period where you're waiting for a release window in your production environment, where it goes into, or to your staging environment, it goes to staging. It takes about a week to deploy to staging. And then 3 weeks later, you can deploy into the production environment. Does that make sense? This is a waterfall-based process. I think we all know that this is horrible, and we've probably all experienced this at one point or another. Process efficiency, by the way, is 30% in this example. Make sense? Good. So what exactly are we doing for a value stream map? The key word here is as is. We are not defining an ideal state. We're not defining what we want the process to be. We're defining what the process is right now. There's a term when you're doing a value stream map called walk the shop floor. It comes from the manufacturing where you would take the first piece, you start at the start and the manager would be there with a little clipboard or the value stream consultant or Six Sigma consultant would walk through and literally walk the shop floor and follow this piece of this widget step by step as it was touched. Who touched it? How long was it touched for? What did they do to it? Step by step until whatever started those raw components came out at the end as a car or whatever it is that you're building. Okay? Now, I should also note, this is a fairly standard value stream map flow, but really it actually doesn't matter what it looks like. Right? Why? Because you're defining a process flow. Your process, I've seen value stream maps where they've got a floor plan of a factory and they've just drawn arrows of where all the components come to and where they flow. That can be very valuable. So, we spoke about value to add time. This is the time spent adding value to the process. And of course, non-value add time is the time spent waiting. Now, we talk about in lean, we talk about wastes. And I won't go into the detail, there are 7 wastes, okay? Transports, inventory, and so forth. If you want to know more about that, read the Wikipedia page. It should explain it relatively clearly. Now, let's take a little bit of a break, and we're gonna start doing this. You're all in teams. Those of you who are sitting at the back who aren't on a table, please come forward and find yourself a table because this is going to be a workshop. What are we going to do? We're going to start to build a value stream map. Now, before you start, here are the rules. This is a workshop. This is an exercise. Okay. So, a couple of things for you to be aware of. Number one, I only want you to define the process steps. I do not want you to define I do not want you to define value add. I don't care about that right now. Right now, I want you to define the process steps. Okay, how is it gonna flow? But you may ask me, what am I gonna draw? What value stream am I going to draw? And the answer is, it's actually gonna be up to you and up to your table. Why? Because it's gotta be an as-is process. It's gotta be something that you all understand. Okay, so some examples, all right? You could draw up your iteration process from sprint planning through to review and retrospective. You could draw up a project management cycle. You could draw up the process it takes to hire a new staff member, okay? What steps you need to go through to recruit someone, okay? You could draw up a funding cycle. How do you get budgets and funds to actually proceed with a piece of work? It has to be something that is repeatable. It has to be something that adds value. But it has to be something that in your teams, your table teams, is something that each of you on this table team can contribute to. So I'm not going to be prescriptive. I've given you some examples. All right. What I'm going to do is I'm going to give you about 5 to 10 minutes now. Start by doing 3 things. 1, come up with a team name, because every team needs to have a name. 2, talk to one another, share business cards if you want, understand what each of you do, understand what your expertise are. 3, understand or find that common value stream. Find that common process that you can draw up, and from there, step 4, I lied, there are 4 steps, draw it. Just the steps, okay? We do this, then we do this, then we do this, then we do this. Any questions? All right, you've got about 10 minutes. I'll give you a 90-second warning, and then we'll close up. Because this isn't a competition, we're not here rushing, we're not going to race, I'm not going to mark you down if you do something wrong. We're here to learn. Right? So, who would like to stand up and give us a bit of a talk about your value stream map? You would? Lovely. Start with you guys. Hang on, sorry, can I get a...
I'm Rohit Srivastava. I'm from Fidelity Investments.
My name is Rajendra. I am from Hexagon.
I'm Krishna Kumar. I'm from Sabre.
So do you want to tell us about your value stream map?
Sure. So here we have seen full cycle of product development as well as distribution. We like to concentrate on increasing the brand value of the cake in India or maybe any other country, but then, yeah. So we have analyzed all the steps and we found out 9 value adds which we can make in this whole process. Number one, yeah, total 9 steps. So number one is finding the current market fact. So obviously as a rookie, when you go to the market, obviously you will not have any product idea or you will not start churning out a new company in the market. First, you will study the facts. So current market facts, checking out how the current companies are working out there. Second is about collecting the data out of it and then analyzing the data. Third is finding out value add which we can make. So first we analyze the current data and then we know that what are the pitfalls which current processes are having, wherein we can stand out and we can make a value addition to the customer. It's not for the profit, but then thinking from the customer's point of view that what value it can have. Also, what is the process of creating the product? So here in baking process is the product making process. So we'll also study, analyze the current baking product and see what all steps are there which can be automated. So if that's a big step, because right now we saw that there is a big line of there is a big production line, so we can automate and reduce waste out of it. Obviously, these are common value adds which anyone can think of and make. Apart from that, some other value adds can be like analyzing the payment options. So is everyone providing the same payment options or is there any value add I can make, my company can make? And finally, when the product will, this is all about the product generation and payment. But in the last, about analyzing the delivery, that how the delivery is happening.
Okay. So I was going to say, that's actually a fairly good value stream. It's looking at a product development cycle. It is a fairly large value stream, and the cadence of that is going to be probably measured in months, if not years, certainly months. But one of the problems with the, actually, who can tell me what one of the problems with a value stream like that might be? It's relatively clear. High level is fine. You can actually have hierarchical value streams. You can do high level, and you can have value streams within value streams. So high level isn't too bad. Measurement and realization of value can be difficult to define, but the actual issue with that is it's going to be from an estimation and from a timing perspective, your value add time. You do it once, you're going to have one set of times. You do it a second time, a third time, a fourth time. I think your variance is going to be quite high. Would this team like to have a go? Someone here? All right.
Yeah. The team name is Mad Agilist, so short Magile. Okay. So the myself, Marutu.
Just go through the list.
Yeah. So the Agile coach from HP.
Just go through the value stream. No, it's fine.
Okay. Okay, so we have chosen the order, online ordering. So we'll get into the value stream of ordering to the product. When he gets the value after the order. So the product selection, then adding it to the cart, payment, shipment, then delivery, then we can eat or use the product, eat the cake or use it.
Okay, so that's a fairly straightforward product ordering process. Now, and I'll actually come back to that one because there's an interesting issue with that process flow, which you'll discover when you start doing the value add timings and the value and the non-value add timings, and we'll talk about that one a bit later. So let's just move on then. We'll go through some of the others. Did anyone have any questions about this? Questions?
Excellent. Thank you.
No. Okay. So most of you have gone through and defined a series of steps, process flows of activities that are have a value. I put three up on the board. Okay, developing a feature, develop, so you design, develop, test, deploy. Highly simplistic, obviously. Hiring staff, write the position description, advertise the position, interview the candidates, select the candidates. Okay, fairly straightforward. Okay. Third one, a help desk request. A request comes in. You triage the request, high, medium, low, how critical is it? It gets assigned to someone to resolve. It gets resolved, hopefully, and then the ticket gets closed. Okay, does that all make sense? These are fairly common. So what I want to look at is look at the value add and non-value add times. All right. So here, developing the feature. Okay, this is in days. 2 days to design, half a day from design to development. 8 days for development, a day to waste, 4 days to test, then 10 days to deploy. Fairly long. That could be hours just as easily. In fact, it probably is hours. Hiring staff, a day to write the position description, 10 days from writing the position description to interviewing the candidates. Why? Because it goes out into the market. You have to, and it go that step of advertising the position takes no time whatsoever. It's a, you write the position description, you press a button, and it's instantly available online. You have to wait 2 weeks to let the resumes come in, interview the candidates for about 2 days, and then you select the candidates. Now, that's a pretty fast hiring process, I think we can all agree, but for the sake of this conversation, let's just use that. And a help desk request. This is now in minutes. Okay, 5 minutes to triage, 2 minutes to assign, an hour to wait from the assignee to begin it, 2 hours to resolve, 10 minutes, then 5 minutes to close. Okay, once again, highly simplistic, not necessarily correct, but good enough for the sake of this exercise. Does that all make sense? Okay. No, we'll do that. I'll talk about this now. Sorry. Once you have these numbers, okay, then you can start to calculate the efficiency. Value add, 14 and a half days, non-value add, 11 and a half days. Efficiency, 55%. Value add, 4. Non-value add, 11. Just count them up. 1 plus 2 plus 1 is 4. 10 plus 1 is 11. Efficiency, 27%. Remember, efficiency is calculated. Value add divided by the total. So 4 divided by 15. All right. Value add, 132 minutes. Non-value add, 70 minutes. 65% efficiency. Now, let's go back to our workshops. And we're actually going to start now put some numbers against this. So before you put it, let's just explain, once again, three things I need you to do. Okay? First of all, figure out what your value add is. Go through each step and go, oh, sorry, actually, zeroth step. Figure out your cadence, your scale. Are you talking minutes, hours, days, or weeks, or months, or years, whatever your cadence happens to be? Okay, figure that out. And each of you is going to be a different. Okay, yours, ordering a process, is in minutes. Right? Yours, which is in hiring people, is going to be in days minimum. Okay. Figure out your value add. Sorry, figure out your cadence. Figure out your value add. Then go through and figure out your non-value add. Then go through and calculate your efficiency, your process efficiency. It doesn't have to be accurate. Once again, remember, how would we do this in reality? Walk the shop floor. In reality, you would actually follow this process through and get actual times. We're not going to do that here, but because we're not going to do that, we're just going to take an average, an estimate. Okay, think about how long you think it normally takes and go from there. Any questions? Okay, so the question was, can you make clear what is value, please people, can you make clear what is value add and what is non-value add? Value add is the time, the duration spent in one of these boxes. How long did you spend designing? How long did you spend developing, testing, and deploying? Non-value add is the wait time, the time in between. So if there's a handover, it could be zero, but if there's a handover between the design and the developers, you calculate what that, it's effectively, if you look at the total process flow, what time is being spent not adding any value whatsoever. Make sense? That's a very good, it depends on the process, but in general, meetings are probably non-value add. Exceptions are things like workshops, which are actually doing design and actually progressing towards that. All right, I'll give you all between 5 and 10 minutes. We'll see how you go. Away you go. Attention, please. Magile, sorry. Okay. So you all now have a value stream map and an efficiency rating. Right? That efficiency rating is something that's a little bit interesting, and it doesn't necessarily have a, what's the word I'm looking for? A low efficiency isn't necessarily a bad thing, and a high efficiency isn't necessarily a good thing, because there can be waste inside your value add steps, and we'll talk about that in a second. But before we get on, let's actually talk to some of, and actually look at some of what you've got. Magiles, can we get you to kick off? Oh, you're just finishing. Okay, who else would like to, actually, the HR team over here. Okay, we'll go with this team here first, because I'm actually really interested in what they will have to say. Stand up and talk about your value stream map.
Good afternoon. Do you need the name of the team as well?
Give us the name of the team. Yeah.
We are the selectors. Our use case is hiring. So cadence is defined in days, right? Right. Like to recruit as soon as we can, as soon as the job description is up there in the system. So the steps are defining the JD, right? And then we have a interaction with HR, make sure it's in as per the organization format.
And can you give us the timings?
Okay, defining the job description and the HR is 3 days. Then the next step is publishing it out externally, right? We do have an internal step, but we are ignoring that for now, right? So. So between, do you need the time between these two?
Please.
Okay. So the time between these two, from the time the JD is described to the time it's getting published externally is 3 days again. Right? And then the publishing aspect, publishing part is just less than a day. So we just said a day, cadence. And then the next step is recruiting agency, which is external, is starting to identify. Based on the JD, the candidates, right? So that takes, so between publishing externally and the recruiters getting started, we average wait period is 2 days, right? so that we get the right recruiters working on the skill sets we need. Then the recruiters itself take 3 days at least, and they are a very reputed firm, so hopefully they have a backlog of resumes ready, and so they take 3 days. Then between the recruiters and the next step is the HR involvement. That's just to make sure that it goes through the HR, so that's instantaneous, 0 days, the time lag. Then HR itself is fairly fast, they take a day. Then the HR contacts the hiring manager, and so that between availability of hiring manager, his priority on other works, there could be a delay of 2 days. And then the hiring manager himself goes through, let's say, it's one resume, right? So one resume, it just takes less than a day, just to review. Obviously, that's not a practical case. We get like 10 resumes maybe. So we said for 10 resumes, it could take close to 3 days. But our use case is for one, so we just said 1 day. We want to see end-to-end mapping for one, recruiting one person, right? So between the HR, the hiring manager taking a day.
What was your overall efficiency?
Oh, okay. We got value-added items at 49 and non-value-added at 16. So efficiency seems to be fairly good, 75%.
Okay, 75% efficiency for a HR department. Do we all agree that that seems about right? No. This is why efficiency isn't necessarily the measure that you really want to be focusing on. Efficiency can be a measure, but a highly efficient, very bad process is actually not is something you want to try and avoid. All right, are you guys ready? All right, let me just scoot over.
So we have in product selections takes 5 minutes, adding to cart, it's very fast. Payment, 5 minutes, all and the product delivery is 10 minutes and product usage is 20 minutes. So those are the main value-added things.
Yeah.
And where the time we spent more is in the waiting the product. So it's a 60 minutes, we said. And once we get the delivery of the product and when we first time start using the product, means we have selected camera. So learning to, camera how to use and all. And first time we take a picture, so we consider it as a product usage. So that time takes around, say, 20 minutes or so. So our product process efficiency comes around 19%.
Okay, so I'm a little bit confused about that one. Your process is to order and ship a product, correct?
Yeah, and purchase a camera from the...
It doesn't matter what it is. Yeah. So what was your non-value add time for shipping?
Wrapping time, packing time, delivery time, and then the unwrapping time.
Yep. How long did you think it was going to take you to ship?
We have taken
including till delivery, we counted around 1 day, same day delivery.
Same day delivery. Okay. So here's the problem. So if that was 1 day, okay, let's make that 8 hours. 8 times 60. All right. So your efficiency was actually more like 3%.
3%. Yeah. Actually, okay. This can be increased. Yeah.
No.
same location, like a pizza, comes
in 30 minutes. Yeah. Fair enough. It depends on your assumptions and the project that you're doing. But the problem, and I said there was a problem with that one, is that they effectively have two sets of cadences. They have one process flow to get a unit ready for shipping, and a second process flow for actually accepting and receiving. All right? You created that as a single process, and so you're... When you look at that as a single process, yes, you've got a shipping activity in the middle. That shipping activity is like measured in days. Everything else is measured in minutes. Okay, so your actual flow is misleading. So for that, you would actually break it into two flows. There's a flow of preparing and taking the order, and there's a and you may even have a shipping flow. Now, you also mentioned when I was talking to you earlier that sometimes the context changes the difference between value add and non-value add. If I'm a shipping company, then that shipping activity is a value-add activity. If I'm the user, then the wait time that shipping occurs, to me, is non-value-add. So always remember that just because you think it's add value doesn't necessarily mean it does. Okay, so just always keep that in mind as well. Okay, does that all make sense? Now, there was a common question that got asked, which I'll actually address and tell all of you, and that was, what happens when you have an iterative cycle, or that you have a split, or that you have multiple activities which sort of happen simultaneously? And there's sort of two answers to that. And the first is, this is a simplistic value stream map. It's a single linear flow. Not everything necessarily has to be linear. And in those instances, what you would do is you would actually, you can create forked or complex value stream maps. But the other thing that happens is often you're misunderstanding where the value creation lies. If it's an iterative process, right, then the value is being created at the end of an iteration. So your value stream map is from the beginning to the end of the iteration. And if you have further activities beyond that, then you're mixing levels. The value is being created in iteration, and you might have one level above that where you have one box which says iterations, and then there are activities which occur along that value stream. So value streams can also exist in a hierarchy. Likewise, when you're doing activities simultaneously, right, then the value that's being created is actually happening at the same time. So in those, you can have complex value stream maps, or you can just consolidate them together into a single process step, or you've actually misunderstood the value stream, and there are actually two different value streams that are occurring. Does that make sense? So there's different ways to visualize and understand. The point is, and this is why walking the shop floor is very important, because you start from the beginning of where something occurs, and you follow it through to the end of that process. Each step does not necessarily mean a change in person. It can be the same person working on each of the steps. It's just where that value is being created. So let's look at a couple of things then. Sorry, there we go. I told you this, Kanban is in the title of this talk. All right, so what is Kanban? Kanban is, at its very simplistic, simplest form, a way of visualizing and tracking, measuring, monitoring, managing the flow of activities, the flow of work through a process, through your value stream. So what you've actually created there are the columns on your Kanban board. Okay, did anyone figure that one out when we started? That's actually the intent of a value stream, or one of the intents of a value stream map. We can now use this to understand and actually start tracking the flow of work through this process, and then use the information from the Kanban board to then optimize our process. We can say, you know what? We're spending 3 days waiting for the HR manager to get back to us. Maybe that step can be refined or optimized in some way because it's acting as a bottleneck to our throughput. Sure, our efficiency is high, but the process is flawed in the first place. So these are the sort of the core principles around Kanban. You can read them as well as I can. Have a read and have an understand of that. Now, I asked at the beginning who here has used Kanban, and that was about half of you. Right, for those of you who are new to Kanban, just a couple of key points. Kanban boards, you've got your columns, you've got your cards that go through the process flow. Right? Every square you've got there acts as a column on that. You can put a post-it note going through every single square and track one unit of work, and your unit of work is an order, your unit of work is HR, your unit of work is a new product. It doesn't actually matter what the unit of work is. You can track one unit of work through that process. Make sense? Now, here's where we want to start limiting work in progress. All right? Yes? Your traditional Kanban board is not the only way of visualizing a Kanban board. If you have to have a forked value stream, and they are fairly rare, you really have to actually start looking at how you're going to be tracking the activities that go through that and how they're going to merge together. So it doesn't have to be linear. I've seen Kanban boards which are circles, okay, because the work activity actually never ends the board. It just continues to go around. So the flow and the structure of the board is actually not relevant. It's as long as you can actually have that post-it note, that card, which is Kanban, that will flow through each stage in that process. Some things will fork. And that's why often when you're forking, you're actually, it's not one process flow, it's multiple process flows. And that's something that needs to be considered. So how do we now turn what you have there into a Kanban board? It's actually really simple, okay? merge the zeros. Okay? Where you have an activity which is zero and zero, zero non-value add and zero value add, or in fact just zero value add to be honest, you basically merge that into the preceding or the subsequent step. Why? Because if you're tracking work and it's instantaneous in a state, there's no point in tracking it through that state. You merge it. So for you, you have product selection, 5 minutes, add to cart, 0 minutes. So if you were going to track something through that state, you would have product selection, add to cart as one step, followed by payment, because you can't track something in an instantaneous state. Now, the next two steps are Kanban, the normal stuff that you do in Kanban. Okay? Define your board policies. What are the rules that each of those steps are defined by? Okay, what are the criteria for entry? What's the criteria for exit? We're agile. What's our definition of done? Make sense? Lastly, calculate WIP. WIP, work in progress. This is the most critical part of Kanban and Lean. You want to have the smallest, lowest WIP possible. Or, sorry, reasonable. Not too small that it artificially creates bottlenecks, but not so large that teams can choose to multitask. Multitasking is one of the worst crimes a developer can do. Okay? Very simple example. If I have 10 activities, each activity takes a day. All right? If I do them at the same time, it will take me 10 days to finish all 10 activities. Make sense?
No.
No?
It may take 12 days or more.
Fair enough. It may take more because there's inefficiencies and there's lag time and lead time and all sorts of other issues. I'm being simplistic here. Okay. If I do them all at the same time, if I'm one developer and I pick tasks 1 through 10 and I start work on one and then I get bored, I move on to the second one, I won't finish any of those tasks until the 10th day or more. If I do them, however, now in series, one after the other after the other, it will still take me 10 days to do all 10 activities. But I'll deliver the first one in the first day, the second in the second day, the third in the third day, and so on and so forth. All right? So I am delivering sooner. Okay? Does that make sense? Now, this also gives me the option to remove activities. This is all agile stuff. We know this. This is why we have iterations. We're allowing that product backlog to change. This is the same principles, but now applied at a micro level, okay, to flow, to activities. We want the lowest WIP possible. Does anyone disagree with what I just said? No? Okay. Repeat after me. Multitasking is bad.
Multitasking is bad.
Good. Okay. Are you going to multitask? No. You probably are. I do. This is actually something that I struggle with, to be honest. Right? Right now, I'm running a startup. I have paying clients. I'm writing a second book. I'm writing articles for a newspaper, for a magazine. And plus, I have all the other little things which I'm doing. Right? Writing papers to speak at conferences. If I was limiting my WIP, all right, I'd be focusing, okay, I'm just going to spend the next 3 months, I'm going to get this book finished. I would have had that book finished 2 years ago. Okay? As opposed to, I would have published my first book, I'm just going to write my second book, and I would have been out in 3 months. Rather than 2 years later going, oh God, I still have to finish that research, I'll do it on the weekend. Limiting WIP means things get done. Not limiting WIP means things will get done much later. Make sense? So now, I'm going to show you how to calculate your WIP. First things first, please, please be aware. What I'm showing you now is how to start. How you continue is to measure, to watch. You will watch the flow on your Kanban board, and you will go, you know what, we need to decrease that WIP because things are moving too quickly through there. Okay? We need to increase that WIP because there's a consistent bottleneck. Okay? So WIP is something that you're constantly reevaluating and changing. So how do we do it? First through, what is your throughput? Okay? Now your throughput depends on your unit of work. Your unit of work, usually in a software context, depends on team size. Okay? So if I'm a software team writing software and my unit of work is a feature, my throughput is in features, which is limited by the size of my team. Okay? Does that make sense? For you, your throughput is a product. Okay? And you might have 20 people working on a product. So your throughput is actually at that group of 20, not that group of one. So figure out what your throughput is. For most of you, your throughput is the same as your team size. One person working on one activity. Make sense? Any what, sorry? No. This isn't a planning activity for the next 3 months. This is your average throughput. How many of these are we going to do? And things like plan leave don't really factor in at this point in time. That's more the micro planning in iteration by iteration. This is more, we just want to figure out what our usual work in progress limits are. So let's look at our total WIP. This is the WIP for the board. What's our throughput divided by our efficiency? Okay? If our team is 7 plus or minus 2, and our efficiency is 55%, then our throughput is 13. Sorry, then our WIP is 13. What does this mean? A team of 7, given the fact that, let's say it's 50%, meaning 50% of the time is wasted, 50% of your time is adding value. Because it's 50-50, I can do 2 activities, develop 2 features in the same time, right, as I could develop 1. Does that make sense? Okay? So my throughput, I take my team size, my team size, divided by my efficiency to give me the total number of simultaneous units of work I can work on at the same time. In this case, it's 13. Yes, you do. You just figured it out. If you don't have your efficiency, and you can't walk the shop floor, as it were, then yes, you're going to make an estimate. So you make an estimate of what your efficiency might be, and then you measure. And then every single day you measure that and go, you know what, we were wrong. And that's okay. Usually. If you're pairing, you divide that by 2. Yeah, well, so if your efficiency is 100%, 7 divided by 100%, 1, is 7. So one person working on one activity is your maximum WIP. Yeah.
You are assuming that one person is doing one activity.
No, I'm assuming that one person is working, and that's why I was talking about you have to figure out what your unit of work is, your throughput, all right? If you have designers, developers, testers, deployers, and they're only working in these context in these spaces, as opposed to working across, then this doesn't necessarily work, because what's happening is that your throughput isn't your team size. Your throughput is the features. How many features can you put through this system? Okay? I'm saying it's equal to team size where there's that constant flow. Or you have the appropriate mix. So if where you have 7 people, where you have 7 people, 2 design, like 1 designer, 3 developers, 2 testers, and 1 deployer, for example, right? Those 7 people, if they equal one consistent flow, one consistent throughput, then yes, it's effectively the same capability. Right? It's only where your throughput is something other that is not related to the team. It's I've got 20 people working on the one activity going through this. So what is going through? How many people are working on that? What is my throughput? That's why we're using the word throughput, not team size. Yeah, I'm using team size as just an example here. Okay? The real answer is what is your throughput? Right. Next, yes? Correct. How do you defend that? So the question is, the lower efficiency allows more multitasking. Yes. So the whole point of this process is to identify those inefficient steps and then try and remove them from the process flow. Okay, so where you have a 55% because you're waiting 10 days between testing and deploying, all right, then what you would do is you would then go, all right, let's actually, we're going to streamline this, increase our efficiency, and that's going to lower our total WIP. By defining the value stream map, you can, you're proactively defining how this all flows. Okay? No, well, if you're using cumulative flow diagrams, then you'd be able to see the balances and the jagged edges, which actually show that, that flow. All right? Otherwise, you're looking for blockers. All right? If you're just looking at a Kanban board. Reducing cycle time can be one example of how you're going to improve your efficiency, but I can just as easily spend more time here and less time here, all right? But my total throughput doesn't change, but my cycle time, sorry, my cycle time might change, but my total throughput wouldn't. So cycle time can be a measure, but sometimes it depends on where the changes lie. So for example, actually, here's a good example. What would, if I changed my development time to 2 days? 2 days to deliver the same outcome, the same feature. What would happen? Well, my efficiency would go down, but I'd still be delivering faster. Does that, everyone agree with that statement? So ultimately, you actually want to bring your cycle time down. You absolutely do want to bring your cycle time down, but cycle time isn't a one-to-one measure for efficiency. All right. So, let me just quickly look at my timing. Yep, I've got a bit enough time. Here, now we actually want to try and calculate what is our WIP limit by state. We know our board WIP. We know that this board, because our total throughput was 14. Okay, so let's look at this. Testing. What is our total WIP? 13. What is the percent effort? 4. If we look at our total value add, 14.5 days, what percentage is testing? Well, it's 28%. We're spending 28% of our value add time in testing. Agreed? All right. 13 times 28% roughly equals 4. Okay? Make sense? So, what is our? We can have a value, a WIP limit for a team of 7 in testing of 4. And so on and so forth, okay? 2 in design, 7 in develop, 4 in test. Now, 0.5, we can't have a WIP of 0, so we make that 1. Because I divided 4 by 14.5.
Can you go back one?
Oh, I'll put all these slides up online, so you don't need to write these down, okay? They'll all be up on the conference website, and I'll put them up, I'll tweet the link, or if you come and get my business card after this, I'll send you the PowerPoint slide. Sorry, no, it's about flow. Forget iterations, forget sprints, this is about flow. What is your simultaneous capability? How many units of work can you do simultaneously? And in this example, we can, because we have a 50% efficiency, we can do 2 things in the same time as we can do 1. Because of that wait time.
So right. We are essentially distributing those 13 into different buckets.
We are distributing those 13 into those different buckets, yes. We have a total WIP of 13. So we distribute them proportionally across each of those states. So in this example, all right. Our cross-functional team, okay, we can do 2 things, we can design 2 things, develop 7, test 4, and deploy 1 simultaneously. That's our work in progress limits. That's how we're going to control that flow. Now, here's the thing about multitasking. Because we have 7 people, but a total WIP of 14, okay, because we've had to turn that 0 into a 1, so it's gone up a bit. Because our total WIP is 14, it's effectively meaning that, yes, our developers are doing two things simultaneously. Why? Because there's this massive weight here. If we got rid of that weight, okay, then our efficiency would go up to 90%. If our efficiency was up at 90%, there's almost no multitasking allowed. So in which case, these would all drop down to, a cumulative WIP of about 7. Okay, 1 design, 3 develop, 2 test, 1 deploy. You can never have a WIP of 0, just remember that. What do you mean? I'm assuming that there's a flow. So it's not about interdependencies or overall overarching architecture. I'm saying that we have a process flow for one unit of work. This unit of work is designing a feature, okay? Oh, sorry, developing a feature. Because of that, the start of that value stream is to do the design, and the end is to do the deployment. Done. Yep. If you have a highly interdependent activity, then it's unlikely that you'll have a value stream map at that level because it's interdependent. You have to bring it up a level to like a master, like an architectural design level, and that's where you would actually start to do some of that. You'd track your WIP at that level. All right, sorry. Other questions? Because this is actually quite important. You're talking about an inconsistent flow. A value stream map is about a consistent flow process. When you automatically have an inconsistency or known bottlenecks, then you would need to adjust the value stream map and thus the Kanban accordingly. So because you've got this bottleneck in terms of testing, they only work 4 days a week or whatever it is, and you know that there's going to be like a buildup of activities waiting to go into testing, then you would need to plan and adjust accordingly. And your WIPs would go up by its very nature because of that massive waiting time. Well, in the same way you would resolve it in any process flow. It's, okay. Think back to what I said at the beginning. This is an simplification of reality. We're abstracting what is actually happening into a model that we can track. Reality is chaotic. So this is, because this is a simplification and a model, by its very nature, all those extreme cases are going to be smoothed out and ignored. So this is not going to work for every case. There are going to be exceptions. There's going to be bottlenecks that are out of your control. Where, however, and Deming talks about common causes and special causes in terms of exceptions, okay, and deviations. Where a deviation is common, it's occurring all the time, then that's when you will need to put in place processes and mechanisms to control and manage that. If, however, your exception, your deviation is caused by something random and unusual, then that's a special cause. We don't actually react to special causes, or we shouldn't. Why? If you saw Snowden's talk in the morning, because those reactions are actually inappropriate to the behavioral change that you're trying to embed. So when you're looking at those deviations, common causes, fix them. Special causes, be aware of them and fix them in the commons, in the specific sense, but don't necessarily adjust your WIP, your flow, or your Kanban because of an exception. Make sense? So you? No, I'm not creating bottlenecks. Can anyone actually answer that question? The question was, am I creating bottlenecks? Because my design is 2 and my develop is 7. Why is that not true? Because of actually the pipeline of work is actually correct. Look at how much time I'm proportionally spending on development to design. Okay? Because I'm spending 4 times as much time on development as I am on design, then I can do 4 designs in the same time I can develop 1 feature. And because of that ratio, the ratio of resources doing that work is also proportioned accordingly. So yes, I might create a bottleneck, but only because my measurements were wrong. Okay? If these are wrong, then this will be wrong. Cycle time, which is the time it takes to go from here, the start of design, to deploy. Lead time, which is the time it takes for an idea to be created, to being it deployed. And time in state, how long it takes to go, effectively these numbers, 2, 8, 4.5, because they show us the flow inside the states. Those are probably the 3 key metrics that you've got. There are others. I'll leave it to you. Look at the Wikipedia page for statistical run charts and cumulative flow diagrams. Those are the 2 primary visualizations, graphical visualizations of process flow through Kanban. The Kanban board is in of itself a visualization, but if you want charts and graphs to see long-term trends, it's the statistical run chart and the cumulative flow diagram.
So Kanban and Kaizen, they work in parallel and it can
represent? Kaizen just means inspect and adapt. Kaizen is the lean equivalent of the retrospective.
So you remove all those inefficiencies, right?
Yes, absolutely. If you're using Scrum or any of the other agile practices and you're holding your regular fortnightly, weekly retrospective, then this is the opportunity to reevaluate. You would look at your Kanban board and you would go, you know what? We've got to fix this wait time. Okay, it's causing so many issues for us. We could deploy much faster if we didn't have to wait for the next deployment cycle. And that's the whole point of Kaizen or those retrospectives, is actually looking at ways of how do we inspect, how do we look at what we're changing and adapt, change it to something that is better. And that's why I say things like WIP limits, your value stream laps, are actually living documents. They're living processes. Every time you look, every time you will use this, sorry, let me just steal this. You will use this to actually visualize and continually reevaluate how good you are. Don't just look at efficiency. I don't like the word efficiency because efficiency makes it sound like you want high efficiency. Sometimes that's bad. Sometimes I actually want to reduce how long it takes me to develop, okay? That will reduce my efficiency, but will overall decrease lead time and cycle time. So it's actually still beneficial. So efficiency is one way of improving, so is improving the productivity within those value add steps. But remember the word value. This is what we're producing. We're producing value at the end. Something of value has been created. That's why we're going through these steps. And as part of Kaizen, as part of inspection and adaption, we're actually going to look at and go, you know what, that step adds no value. We're going to remove it. Okay? The HR example, brilliant example. You had a lot of steps in there, which you could just completely remove. And because even though there were steps, they were activities, they actually weren't adding value. So you're not adding value while you're doing them. Okay, so the question is, in terms of if your resource load is fixed, efficiency, yes. If you have a team of 7, you can do those efficiencies in terms of, okay, we're going to improve so on and so forth to get better at our throughput. But if they're not cross-functional, if, for example, all right, we're saying that our developers, okay, they're dedicated developers, dedicated designers, dedicated testers, this is causing a bottleneck. What do? You go, you know what, we actually need another developer. Our team size is going to go up to from 7 to 8. And the way to resolve that bottleneck is to increase that developer. And remember, we're trying to reduce weight. We're trying to reduce waste. And as part of that, you can actually get rid of people. You could say, you know what, our developers are a bottleneck. So what we're going to do, so our designers are designing faster than our developers can develop. We're going to get rid of designer. What does that do? it reduces your total throughput, but because you're reducing your waste, because you would then have less bottlenecks, you're actually going to develop faster. No, sorry, not faster, sooner. Let's be clear, sooner, not faster. Absolutely. The actual steps themselves, like, you may completely throw out this value stream map after 3 months and go, you know what, we're going to find a different way of working because this isn't working for us. Absolutely. The value stream map is as is, as I said at the very beginning. This is only looking at the as is processes as to right now, today, how is this working? And tomorrow, we're going to remove steps, add steps, change them, get rid of them entirely.
Eliminate waste.
I'm going to, because I'm out of time now, let me give you the 6 steps. This is the Toyota production system. These are their 6 rules to Kanban. All right? This is where you need to think about how you manage your process flow, how you manage your value stream map, how you manage your Kanban board, your WIP limits. This is the rules to the board, to how to run the board. All right, I've got 5 minutes left. I've been answering questions for the last 10 minutes, and I'll just keep answering questions until you guys are done. Okay, so you're asking what parameters, what metrics you're going to look at.
Right.
Here's the question. Sorry, do you know, if I use the word vanity metric, do you know what I mean? Okay, a vanity metric is something that you measure that if you improved it, if you made it from 7 to 10, would have no substantive benefit to the value outcomes. All right? So when you're looking at parameters, when you're actually looking at things to measure, you have to be very careful that what you're measuring and what you're actually improving has a subsequent benefit to the process and to the steps that you're undertaking. So I can't tell you what the standard parameters are because it really will depend on your process. But just always be aware the difference between a real measure and a vanity measure or a vanity metric. How do you make sense of a community flow diagram? Come and talk to me afterwards. I'll actually show you a cumulative flow diagram, and I'll put it up on the screen, and I'll actually show you how to view it. It's probably it's beyond the scope of what I can talk about there.
So in this, we have said not pairing in one of the examples.
Sorry?
Not pairing.
Not pairing.
Work in progress limit. Somewhere we said not pairing. So
So here.
Also apply for pairing when it is pairing.
My team size. Okay. So if I have a cross-functional team, if I'm think of it in terms of throughput isn't the team size. I'm using that as an example, okay, to simplify this. If I have one person working on one feature, then yes, my throughput is going to be the same as my team size.
Okay.
If I've got 2 people working on one feature, then obviously my throughput is going to be half my team size.
Okay.
So that's why if you're pairing and it's cross-functional and so forth, then that's going to be reduced by, that's going to be halved.
Okay.
Sorry, you had a question? Because depending on how you set up your board in Jira, it's been a couple of years since I've used Jira. You should be able to. There should be metrics to show when things are marked done, and if you have WIP limits configured, it should show you the time it spends in each state and the time it spends waiting to enter a state because that state is full, and that waiting time in between states. Oh, look, Jira has a Kanban board. In it. It should have all that for you. Sorry, three more questions and then we'll close it. Correct, yes. You can use Kanban and Scrum together. It's colloquially known as Scrum Ban. Some people think it's actually a bad idea. I think it's actually very good because Scrum is actually at a macro iteration level, whereas Kanban can be used within the iteration to track your flow in iteration. Really advanced Agile. If you talk about continuous delivery, if we talk about, and here's a great, Amazon deploys to production every, depending on who you ask, between 7 and 11 seconds. That's a continuous delivery approach. All right? That's pure Kanban. Activity goes in, it gets deployed at the end of that cycle. Right? So that's the more advanced. But standard Agile using Scrum or other iterative incremental processes, yes, you can easily wrap. If you can write a value stream map, you can use a Kanban board. So we are taking an average, and that's what I was saying at the very beginning. Because we're taking an average, because we're looking at the, if a process has a major variance, okay, so one process might take a day to design, another might take 12 days, and you just have this massive variance, then it's very hard to actually have that smooth flow. So in those cases, Kanban and those WIP limits aren't going to work very well because you can't actually have a consistent flow. Right? Where you've got a P50 plus or minus 50% to in terms of that variance, this works much better. Yep?
Last question. So for all this, the basis is proper estimation, right? And I found by practice in Agile, it's very difficult to have the right estimation because Agile itself is very agile.
Yep. That's a special cause. If things are going wrong, and you just need to fix them. Anyway, time's up. Thank you very much. If you have questions, come and have a chat with me at the front. I'm happy to talk. If you want a copy of the slides, come and get me. I'll give you my card.